In a lot of companies, when they start with Scrum, Agile, or Kanban, these kind of things, the focus is very heavily on the team. You know, technical practices, people start talking about TDD, continuous integration, and these kind of things. So it's a lot focused on the actual developer and development kind of things. But the kind of like business side of software development is also important. And in a Scrum team, for example, taking that as an example here, the role of the product owner is really, really important. Think about it that you have a high performance car, boat, ship, whatever you want, but you have no direction where you're going. You know, you're driving really fast, no direction, no course, no nothing. You're not going to be very successful. You need to have a goal, a clear goal where you're going. And that goal has to be based on some kind of understanding the needs of your customer and what you're actually trying to achieve. And then you, of course, need the good team that can actually deliver on that. But if you don't have both, you're kind of lost. So I kind of intend to a little bit talk about things that go wrong with product owners, give you some examples of, let's say, bad behavior or things that I've seen, as well as what kind of makes up a good product owner, what kind of characteristics there are behind that. Slightly talk about how you can develop yourself a little bit. And maybe give you a quick overview of some tools. We don't have that much time. And if you know, we're doing a certified Scrum product owner training here today and tomorrow. So we spend 2 days just going through how you do that work. So of course, in kind of 45 minutes, you can only like give you the the topics of what we would go in a training like that in much more detail. But I can give you a quick hint and a quick idea of what kind of things there might be in there. So, and of course, I'm also here the rest of the evening, so if you want to talk to something, just let me know. So, that's first. How many of you are product owners right now? Who works as a product owner? 2, 3. Okay, how many here are doing Scrum or have a good understanding of Scrum? Roughly half. Good. So we actually know when I say Scrum and product owner what I'm meaning here. Good. Just want to check. So, just as a refresher, this is what the Scrum Guide says. So that would be an official source. What is a product owner? The product owner is responsible for maximizing the value of the product and the work of the development team. The product owner is the sole person responsible for managing the product backlog. That's what it says. But, okay, there are a couple of other things in here. The first thing that is important is maximizing the value of the product. So, there are two things here. One is the return on investment, you know, maximizing the value. That being said here, and the work of the development team. If you want to look at the cost, cost is usually like people working on something, that's where you have the cost. But you want to maximize the value. The cost you can't really that much play with usually. You have a fixed team, you have pretty much fixed costs. So the thing you can play with as a product owner is the value. And there's one thing here that the product owner uses to do that, and that's the product backlog. That's what the product owner does. Through ordering his product backlog, he tries to maximize the value produced by his team. What he does is trying to maximize the return on investment. The investment being the time on the team, or other resources that you're using there, and the value being the getting out as much as possible from that team as you can. However, there are a couple of other things that are really important in my opinion as well. And that is job direction and leadership to a team. So, this is probably one of the more tricky things for many product owners. They think they're only managing, you know, things, the backlog, just ordering it. But actually what you're also providing is direction and leadership to a team. To show them where you want them to go. Not just by giving them user stories, here are some user stories, please go and do. But by providing them a kind of vision of where the journey is going. We have this wonderful idea of a nice new product that we want to build. We've done all the market research. This is going to sell like crazy once it's done. This is what we're going to build. Provide that kind of direction. And through that also the leadership to go in that direction. Versus hear some user stories, just go off and implement them and come back in 2 weeks and tell me and show me how you've done it. That's a big difference between those kind of two styles. And what I've seen is a product owner that is more in the kind of leadership, can motivate the people, can engage them and make them really excited about what they're doing, is going to have a much better success than the one who is only working with his backlog and just throwing out user stories to a team. So think about that. That's slightly different than perhaps what a lot of people are used to when they are at the product owner in a company. At least the ones that I've seen. However, please remember the product owner doesn't have to be alone in this. So you can have multiple product owners, you can have a product owner team if you want to. It doesn't have to be that you're all alone and it's only your responsibility and no one else is helping you. Of course you can have a team who's supporting you. You think in any big product, you know, a mobile phone is built with Scrum, that there's one product owner on his own, working on the whole thing? Of course not. There's a whole bunch of them. Same as you could have a whole bunch of teams working there. So, no problem. Have a whole good team. Have a team of good product owners that work together as a team, giving direction and leadership to all the teams that you have in a big project. Cool. So, some examples of anti-patterns and behavior. First one, this is quite often, the no power product owner. Anyone ever seen that? You have a product owner who can never actually decide anything? He always is like, I have to ask someone else first, or he's very indecisive. So if you ask him a question, he really doesn't know. He goes like, I don't know, maybe that, maybe not. How does it feel to work with such a product owner?
Kill him.
Yeah. Or ignore him completely.
Kill him and make his boss as the product owner.
Yeah. So after a while you don't even bother asking him, because why would you ask him? He never knows the answer. He can never say, okay, I understand, let's do this. That would be a clear direction. Let's do it like this. So what can you do when they have product owners like this? You already mentioned one, the killing part.
This is funny, but
maybe not a good career move on your side, but it would work.
As a matter of fact, I've been a product owner myself, yeah. So I have seen both sides. Try to engage.
You're still alive?
Hmm?
You're still alive?
Yes. To kill me, it would be quite difficult and dangerous.
Yeah.
Because I would make a decision to remove such problem. First of all, try to contact other product owners involved in the process, because it would be solved by them, not by you. Escalate the problem. If it's not this way able, escalate to his boss.
Sure, that is one thing. What could be reasons behind product owner not having power?
There are many differences,
yes.
Personality.
That is definitely one.
Micromanagement from customer sense. They always want to take everything.
Why not? Might also be a lack of actually mandate from his boss.
Yes,
that his boss hasn't given him the power to make decisions,
yes, exactly.
But said, sorry, but you're not allowed to make any decision, even if he wanted to. He couldn't, because he doesn't have the permission to make any decisions. There, in the worst case, there are companies where the CEO doesn't give permission to his underlings to make any decisions and says, everything has to be decided by me. And this might be a 100-person company. Think about that. Everything going up to the CEO and then going down again. The example I'm making is a company that I think originally had 7 management layers in a 100-person company, and the CEO wanted to decide everything. They're still in business, but they're radically different these days. But so you have this kind of thing. So management doesn't support him, doesn't have the right sponsorship. You know, even his boss might not have the power to make decisions, and there might be some political infighting in there that makes it really difficult for him to make decisions. So if you have this situation that you're in a team and the product owner doesn't have the power to decide, you really need to think hard and find out where's the actual problem here. Because just saying that our product owner sucks and let's kill him might not be the answer, because the next one that comes in has exactly the same problem.
As a matter of fact, saying this is a way to engage team in problem and to help solve this.
Yes.
Because everyone in team they engage feels this way to kill me. If you pronounce, you can laugh about it and then go to reasonable parts to do something.
But the thing here is, you need to figure out why the product owner has no power. And you need to address that problem. And it might be an organizational issue. It might be a high-level management issue. It's not usually something directly with the team and product. It might be over there in your big organization. And that can be tricky to find that out of. Even more tricky to actually change that.
But if that's a contract like between two companies, one is supplier, one is the contract doesn't allow to make the decisions, but the one who asks for the the one who pays for the project doesn't want to be a project owner, but then they don't allow and they don't do it themselves.
It gets much more tricky when you have two companies in there, one of them acting as a supplier, the other as the customer. Then it's even more tricky because of contracts and all that kind of stuff, especially if the product owner is on the, well actually on any side it might be the same problem. If it's on the supplier side, he doesn't really have the power to make decisions for the customer because the customer says that we're deciding, and if the product is on the customer side, you might have the political problems and so on. But you need to find a solution there. Because without solving that problem, you're going to have much more problems along the way. Like you said, the team feels like they want to kill the product owner because he's useless.
Well, no, he's even making problems for the team.
That might be in the extreme case. So you have to figure out some kind of way to do that. But the solution depends a lot on the problem that you actually have. Another common thing, the too busy product owner. Typical kind of story behind it is, it's Monday morning, we're having our sprint planning at 9 o'clock. Product owner comes at 9:15, of course, to the meeting room, 15 minutes late, since he was in the previous meeting, right? He started already at 7 in the morning, he's a busy guy. At 9:15, he sits down and gets out a couple of post-its and starts writing a couple of user stories. These will be the user stories for this sprint. Here. Now, please go off and implement. We're now at 9:30 to 9:45, and he's off to the next meeting. Anyone seen that? I made it a bit more extreme maybe, but I've seen that happen quite a lot of times, that the product owner starts writing the user stories and thinking about what to do next in the actual planning session. Why does it happen? What do you think?
Better is an organized person, but the situation too much things on one person.
Anyone ever ask the product owner how many products or projects he has at the same time? I've met ones that have like 3-4 of them at the same time. Plus all the other stuff they're doing. You know, they sit in different kind of other management organs and meetings and stuff like that. So they're busy, 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 and they don't want to let go of anything. By the way, guess why they don't want to let go of anything? Because the more projects you have, the more power you have in the organization, and also the more prestige, you know. I have 5 projects, you only have 2. I'm better than you. Mine is bigger than yours.
There's also a lack of resources.
That's also. But that could be solved, just hire a couple more people.
Organizations don't want to solve that problem.
Yeah, unfortunately. So they pick the worst solution. They have extremely busy people who never even think about what they're doing. They just do something. The result is they build usually total crap, but hey, that doesn't count since we're busy, right? And you only see that it's crap 5 years later, or when you actually look at the whole thing and say, this didn't sell. So I've seen that quite a bit.
There is also that the product owner has quite a high requirements. Like, you need to know the business quite well.
Definitely.
You need to have that vision, and also probably some technical background also. So it's
on the technical, I don't agree, but
okay.
on the you have to understand the business, definitely. Yeah. And you have to have the domain knowledge.
And analytical things, like you have to be seeing structure. You cannot take any business person and put
same. Yeah, definitely. And it's the same as with any job. You can't just take any person from the street and say, you know, a Java developer, look, come, you're as good as any other expert we have.
It's like, you cannot take an accountant and make him the owner of a...
Not without training.
Yeah.
As in anything, you need to learn how to do that role. You need to train that person, you need to coach that person. Training is not enough. You know, I tell you 2 days on how to do it, and you're of course the total expert, right? No. Someone needs to sit down with you and actually show you how to do it and answer your questions that come along, and that takes at least, I'd say, a couple of sprints. Usually when I'm with a product owner, I want to work with him for 1 to 2 sprints at the minimum. Just because you need that long to get used to how the things actually work. By the way, in the extreme case, this can mean there's no product owner at all. You know, he's so busy, he doesn't ever show up. That's like the total extreme that we can have. Okay, so what else? Half product owner. What do I mean with that? Anyone not have a product manager? Half product owners often come when you have an existing organization with existing roles. Now they start using Scrum. So they retain or keep all the old roles they have in the organization, product manager, project manager, and whatever else they have in the organization, and they just add on top of that all the Scrum roles. So they have even more roles. Of course, all the old roles have pretty much the same old descriptions, and then you add the other ones in there. So you're actually taking the product owner role and basically leaving the product owner only stuff that is not in the old roles, which usually means everything where it says product backlog, because the old role doesn't have product backlog in its description, you leave that as the product owner, and all the else starts with the product manager. This goes as a relative of the no power product owner, but it's slightly different. Because here, a lot of the power actually lies with the product manager. You know, he still has, for example, the vision, or the release plan, or talking to customers, and these kind of things. And the product owner then just does the user stories and the product backlog. So what happens? Similar to as with the no power product owner, the actual product owner has to go to the product manager and ask him, so, what do we do next? What did you tell the customer? And then he has to go back to the team and give them all the details. So it often happens when you split the product owner role into small things. Don't split the product owner. There's a reason why he has the responsibilities that he has. And don't make it like tinier and tinier. The same applies actually with the Scrum Master. Also don't do the same thing with the Scrum Master and a project manager. But you're like, the Scrum Master gets the stuff that the project manager didn't already have. That doesn't also make any sense. So if you apply Scrum to an organization, actually think about redesigning all the roles in your organization. Don't just add the new ones on top. You already have enough of them usually. So I can give you an example of what we've done. Bigger customer of ours, let's not mention any names, but big. We're talking just one department, might be 500 people. That's medium sized. They have bigger ones, just one department. So what we did, for example, there is we redefined all the roles that they had. All the roles they had existing there. So Scrum and Agile and all those ideas, and come up with new role descriptions for the whole organization. So look at the whole thing, update the whole thing, and then put it out. And tell people, now you have to reapply for whatever role you want to take. And they were radically different, so if you didn't have project managers anymore, no product managers, instead you had scrum masters, product owners, and so on, so line management, and these kind of roles. And people could choose what they wanted to do, so we asked people. So you were a project manager, what would you like to do? Do you want to become a scrum master? Do you want to become a product owner, or what? And people could choose. So, don't just add new roles to an organization, really rethink it. That's when we talk about an agile transition. It's not just adding some scrum in the bottom, it's actually rethinking the whole organization. The far, far away product owner. What would that be? Anyone had a product owner in the USA?
You just have to have a planning at 4 o'clock.
Yeah. What time did you have your plan?
We had a meeting at 5 p.m. probably 4 p.m.
It's when he woke up.
Yeah. He was in a car, driving to work.
That makes being difficult, right? My rule of thumb for organizations is don't have a time difference bigger than 3 hours. Bigger than 3 hours makes it really tricky to work together. So having a product owner in the USA and a team, for example, here in Riga, has its problems when it comes to communication. You could think that, okay, let's just do it by email. What would be the problem with email communication? So today, it being Thursday, you sent him a question during your work day, right? And he answers during his work day, which means you get the answer on Friday. And Friday morning when you come to work. Right. Now he misunderstood your question, so he answered the wrong thing. So you rephrase your question and send it back again. Now he of course answers it on his Friday, which for you is Friday evening, you're already partying out hard. So you get the answer on Monday morning. Now, how does that make it difficult with a 2-week sprint? 10 days, and you just waste 2 or 3 days just to get one question answered? You're just like verifying that we're going in the right direction? It's way too slow. So communication between product owner and team should be more or less instantaneous. You have to have enough common time so you can call him on the phone and say, Mr. Product Owner, we have a problem. And then you describe the problem, and he listens, and he can give you an answer immediately. For that, you need to have enough common hours during the day. And you, at least my experience with the guy in the US is Finland is in the same time zone, so even the 5 p.m. thing is tricky. Because you still have only like 1 or 2 hours to hit him, and he either is in the car or he has a meeting in the morning or something like that, and he's busy. So even getting him on the phone is really difficult.
Get him to show up for standards.
Yeah, I'm gonna try a sprint planning. How long does a sprint planning take for a 2-week sprint?
2 to 4 hours.
2 to 4 hours, which means you have to have 2 to 4 hours where the product owner is available at the same time as the team. So if you start at 5 p.m., the next 4 hours means for developers here would be until 9 in the evening. It has to do sprint planning. Not a very fun thing to do every 2 weeks. I don't know how the contract says. I know in India they might do things like, in Finland, no one would do it. They would kill you. The team would say, no way in hell I'm going to work until 9 in the evening just because our product owner is so far away. He needs to wake up earlier. That didn't work.
In our case, she was the busy product owner connection.
Yeah, also at the same time. Makes it even more difficult. Time zone difference, busy, and all the other things. Did she have power?
That's the best case. Wake up at 2 in the morning every day.
So have at least something.
Call him while he's sleeping.
Another one. Product owner by committee. What does that mean?
So there's no single person.
There's no single product owner that can decide anything. There's always a committee who needs to first have a discussion.
Have a meeting.
Yeah, have a meeting and a discussion. There are certain countries where these kind of things are popular, let's say like that.
Scandinavian?
Certain Scandinavian countries have a culture of discussion, yes. Let's not name any names, I don't know if there's a room. But yeah, I worked once in Finland in a bank, they had this problem. They always had to decide everything by committee. Made everything terribly slow. Also makes it highly political because there are a lot of people in there who are not really interested in the product, they're just interested in different things. You know, their stuff, and making sure the other one doesn't get his stuff. So I look good, he looks bad, so I get my bonus and he doesn't get his, and these kind of things. Also, they usually have to all agree, you know, if you get these kind of committees, they might have like, we have to have a unanimous decision by all the five product owners in the room that we're going to do this. If one disagrees, we're not going to build it. Trying to get five business people to agree on anything is usually quite tricky and takes a long time. So you get this kind of saying, have you ever heard this? Death by committee. By the way, if you look at the European Union, they're probably full of that kind of stuff. Would be my guess. Probably a lot of governments as well. Parliament has a lot of committees probably, and a lot of preparations and endless discussions on things and so on.
Any large organization with many departments involved in one product would be this kind of situation.
Yeah. But one of the reasons why we do Agile is that we can react quickly to a changing environment. And having an organization set up to discuss ideas to death and never actually come up with a decision doesn't fit with that. And decision doesn't mean that we can't change it, you know. We're talking Agile here. We're doing stuff in small iterations and increments. So if we decide to go that way, 2 weeks later we can decide to go the other way in the next sprint. So what's the harm of, let's just quickly come to a decision what looks best right now. In 90% of the cases you're anyway right, and 10% when you're wrong, you still did probably 80% of the right stuff. So you only changed this slightly small thing that you didn't really guess right. So make quick decisions. I know it's not the culture in some countries. I have never worked myself in the US, but I at least imagine the Americans are slightly less on the design by committee and more by this is the direction where we're going and let's do it. Germans are somewhere in between. They also have some examples. Germans sometimes can give you quite clear directions, but they also like to have meetings and discuss things. Not as bad as certain Scandinavians do, but still. Okay. Another example. Proxy product owner.
Is it similar to no power?
Slightly, but now you have officially created a role in the organization called a proxy product owner.
Oh, okay.
So you have actually another product owner, you know. The reason why you often create this is as a workaround for, let's say, the faraway product owner. So your product owner is in the US, the team is here, so you go like, okay, because it's difficult to ask the US product owner, let's make a product owner over here to speak for the product owner over there.
But that could work if this proxy can answer at least half of the questions. A half proxy product owner.
If he's good at mind melding with his other product owner, right? Yeah, if they have some kind of mental connection where they can read each other's minds and the other one doesn't change his decisions the next day. What often happens here is the proxy decides one thing, then the other product owner finds out and decides the other way. So what does a team do if this happens a couple of times?
They're applying the spring. The brains.
They just keep ignoring the proxy product owner because they know the other one is going to do something else anyway. Or they just ask the other one and the proxy is just in between and doesn't actually do anything. Anyone know the exercise called the broken telephone? So broken telephone goes, I take you, whisper something in your ear, you whisper in his ear, you whisper in your ear, and and so on, it goes through the whole way, and then at the end of the room, you tell us what you heard. And it's something completely different from what I said. That's what you get with the proxy protocols easily.
But this could work if you send the proxy product owner to the other product owner to spend time and get the vision.
Sure, he would get the vision, but does he get the details?
It's possible.
And you would probably have to sync them constantly, which means he has to constantly keep in touch with him and talk with him. Often the proxy product owner only also created because the other one is too busy to talk with the other one, which means he's too busy to talk to the proxy. So here again,
it should be like good friends, good relationship, now similar background, so maybe.
How often have you seen that?
I think yeah.
Identical twins would be great. So yeah, usually it doesn't work. Of course it could work, but I've never really seen it work well. Often it creates problems.
Especially if one is talking to the customer, the real one, and the proxy is not. Yeah, so.
And that's in the broken telephone. You always lose information in between. And based on the information you have, you make decisions, and suddenly you get a lot of misunderstandings that can be really costly. The proxy didn't understand the requirement that came from the customer the same way as the original product owner did. So he tells the team the wrong thing, which again has a misunderstanding again. So you agree like this, and in the end, you get something completely different than what the customer wanted. Mm-hmm. Yeah. The customer asked for a horse, and the team delivers a duck. That's what they understood, so they build it. Customer says, this is not what I wanted. And then you're explaining. So, these are a couple of examples that I've seen. There are plenty more probably, but these are the typical ones that happen with product owners. So keep an eye out for this, and if you see them, try to figure out how you can manage them and actually work around them and make it work. If you have a proxy that doesn't work at all, what can you do to fix it? I don't know. Maybe the real product owner could become actually a product owner. Maybe he's too busy. If he's too far away, maybe someone else in the organization is closer, location-wise, that could do the same job. Perhaps the team is in the wrong place. Sometimes organizations just create teams because we just had a couple of guys free here, so let's make them over there. Even though the product owner is over there, and they would have developers over there as well, they just were busy. So you might have to reorganize how you do your stuff. I've seen organizations where it goes like this. Product owner is here for a team that is here, and a product owner is here for a team that is there. That doesn't make any sense. Why don't you have a product owner here for the team that is there? This happens often. And actually, when you ask the company, they don't know why they did it. It just happened. Actually, I have an idea why it happened in that specific company. It has to do with their resource allocation process, what they call it. You know, they made a new project and they looked just on their Excel sheet, where we have people free with the right skills, and they just put people together with the right skills, and the people were not even in one location because they were all over the place. And then they said, oh, we have a team. Yes, great. Yeah, the team is in 5 different locations in a couple of different countries. What's the point in that? And they could have allocated them in different ways, which might be slightly more difficult at the beginning, but once you get the hang of it, it makes much more sense.
Cool.
So, characteristics of a good product owner. What could we have? There's actually a long list here. I picked out a couple of ones. This I've mentioned. You need to have authority. If the product owner does not have the authority to make decisions, he definitely needs to get that. This doesn't mean he has to have unlimited authority. You know, he's not God. At least I hope so. Actually, I had once a team draw me a picture where, you know, we do exercises with them to draw a metaphor for product owners, Scrum process. They drew as the product owner God, the Scrum Master was the priest, and the followers were the team. That was an interesting picture. And God had a backlog. Do good things and multiply in the earth and things like that. But a product owner needs to have enough power to make decisions within the context of that project. So it might be that he can, in certain boundaries, decide things. Once he has to go outside that boundaries, he might have to go to someone higher up in the food chain to get permission to do that. But he needs to have a big enough box to play in. If the box is tiny, he's a sad product owner.
Yeah.
I want a bigger sandbox. More toys. Another one, knowledge. If you have a product owner who doesn't know anything about what the hell he's building, how does he make any good decisions?
Make a backlog in that case.
Yeah, it gets really difficult, but you sometimes find these kind of product owners who are pulled somewhere out of the organization to be the product owners of something due to whatever reasons. Usually these product owners have really nice titles. VP of something, CTO, you know, and often I'm quite clueless about the business, but since I'm the son of the founder of the company, therefore I get to be the product owner.
This is our new perspective product, our future, yeah, so we want to put a really important version of the product on.
They lack the actual knowledge there,
yeah.
And the other guys are really frustrated, who are actually doing a lot of the job of what the product owner should do. They have the knowledge, but the guy that is running as product owner doesn't know anything. And the other ones see immediately that he's making a lot of bad decisions there, because he doesn't know what he's doing. The same goes to having a program who doesn't know how to be a program. No training at all, no nothing. He just goes like, do this. You know, comes in, no user stories, no backlog. I'm just like, I'm the product owner, so I know what I'm doing. Doesn't work. Last one, time. Goes back to the no time product owner. You need to have time to be a product owner. So for any non-trivial project or product, with non-trivial I mean you have a decent-sized team, 5 people for example, this is a full-time job most of the time. It's not like something to do with 10% of your time or 20%. You need 100% to be a good product owner. It's not just you have 15 minutes to write some user stories for your team. You need to think about the stories, not just the stories. You have to understand what are the needs of our customer and user. To really understand what the problem is, to really understand where we want to go with our product, and all of that takes time. It's not something you do in a couple of minutes. So you need time. A couple of other good things that a program needs: be a visioner and a doer. You know, if you want to do things, you need to have a clear vision. Even if you're a bit unsure yourself about your vision, at least communicate a clear vision and show a clear direction to your team. Because if you're unsure, the team is going to be even more unsure of what they're doing. And if the team is unsure, the product is going, you know, somewhere. People like to have clear direction often. It feels much better when someone tells you, okay, this is the direction that we're going with the whole company now, instead of we have no clue what our company is doing. Usually that means that developers start looking for a new job. Risky sign that the company is going down because they don't know what we're doing. So.
We have some budget here, let's just make something.
Let's make something, yeah. But it's not that interesting. I'd rather be in a company that knows what they're doing and I can believe in what they're doing. So another thing here is be a good leader and team player. You have to have the kind of character to get people to believe in you and want to follow you. And want to follow you into really tight and difficult things. Not just say, follow me, and assume that everyone is following you. That doesn't happen. You know, when the going gets tough, people will stick with you. And things will get tough in projects sometimes. Another good thing is you have to have good communication and negotiation skills. Because you're going to communicate with stakeholders, with your team, with all kinds of people. You have to negotiate with your team, you have to negotiate with your customers and these kinds of things. Because it's not just that I'm the Mr. Product Owner, therefore I decide what you do, and here's what you're going to do, team. It's always a negotiation with the team. The team has good ideas also on where to take the product, so you can't just be a dictator. We had enough of these in the bureau already, so let's not put them in there. really wanting to get it done. If you are not committed, why should the team be? You know, if the team feels that you're just doing it because you're told, versus I believe in this and this is going to be a great thing, then the team is going to follow you. So these kind of priorities. The product owner is not an easy one. How much time is there left?
Please, half an hour.
Okay, so no hurry. So, some tips here. Understand yourself. These are actually not really specific to being a program. This can be applied to all of your life. Understand yourself. Where are your strengths and where are your weaknesses in yourself, in your character? What things you need to develop in yourself? Understand that, okay, I might not be the best possible communicator, but I'm good in these things. Once you understand where you're good and where you're not good, you can get help on these things. You can ask someone to mentor you, you can ask someone to coach you, you can take a training, these kinds of things. Don't come in assuming you're perfect and I don't need to learn anything. No good product owner is born a good product. See one pop out. Anyone seen a baby that is a good product owner? And so you need to learn. Another one is develop and grow. You know, once you know where your weaknesses and your strengths are, make yourself a plan on how are you going to improve yourself. This is something that anyone should do in their life constantly. Think about how can I become better at whatever I'm doing. Person, become better at my job, whatever. And there are different options you get. My favorite here, get the authority. He's like my authority. I need some luck. You need to have it. If you can't have it, if you don't have it, it's not going to work. I've mentioned getting coached a couple of times, and I keep mentioning it because this is actually the thing that is lacking in most companies. It is all about, okay, let's send our guys to a two-day training, and when they come out of training, they're the perfect whatever. The perfect Scrum Master comes out of a two-day Scrum Master training, right? He's certified. He has to be perfect. Right? Right. It's like saying you're, what's the national sport here?
Hockey.
Ice hockey? Cool. In Finland. So, your national team, why does it have a coach? Coaches are totally unnecessary. We have professional players, they're really great at what they do, right? So let's just throw them together in a team and send them off to the tournament. That works, right? So why do we have a coach? Fire him. You don't need one. What's the role of a coach? Why do you have a sports coach?
To make the team more efficient than a single person in the team.
Yeah. As a matter of fact, make the team to be a team, yeah. Because it's a bunch of individuals, yeah. Without a coach.
These are things that a coach would do in that kind of team setting. But coaches, so not necessarily a sports thing, I don't know enough about hockey. So to be an expert in there. But coaches also help individuals. Just how do you become better? A lot of these things are not just that I can tell you, this is how you do it. I can give you theory, I can give you knowledge. That's what a teacher can do. I can mentor you. Is that what mentoring is? Mentoring is when you have the experience in applying this thing and you show how to apply it. However, there's one weakness in mentoring. In mentoring, you have to intimately know the problem to know the right solution, because you're giving solutions there to your mentor or mentee. Weird word. So you're giving him solutions, you know, do this, do that. And you can only do that if you really, really know what the problem is and what the right solution is, or what a possible right solution is. Which is really tricky, because you have to probably spend as much time as your mentee on the problem to know what you're going to do there. The other option is coaching. Coaching is not about the coach giving the coachee a solution. It is about helping and enabling the coachee to find his solution on his own. So if you're coaching a product owner, you help the product owner to learn how to do his role independent of the coach. So that's kind of like our definition of what coaching actually means. There are different kinds of coaching as well, so you could... Anyone has ever had a life coach? Mm-hmm. Heard of that? So some people get life coaches just to coach them in their life. What do you want to achieve in your life? You start out with creating a vision or an idea where you want to go. If you have a goal, you know, I want to be whatever. The mom with a great family or something like that. And then the coach can help you achieve that goal by helping you figure out what you actually need to do. So if you have problems as a product owner, you see that a product owner has problems, get him some help. You don't have to look for an outside person. You might have most likely someone in the company who can help. If you have some great Scrum Masters, ask a Scrum Master. It doesn't have to be the Scrum Master of that team. Get one from another team to sit at least a couple of hours per week with your product owner to help him. If you don't have something internal in your organization, get someone external to help. Because if you don't...
It isn't external either, because then you can easier talk about your weaknesses and...
Yeah, often it is.
Yeah, so...
Also, an external has a more naive view of the organization, which often helps you when you question the things. Because you see things differently, you know? You're not blinded by the problems of the organization. If you've been in a company for many years, you often don't even see what the problem is anymore. So it is difficult to ask the right questions from whoever you're coaching so that he understands what the problem is. That's actually the tricky thing when you coach. Sometimes you notice what the problem is yourself, but how do you get the coachee to understand what the problem is without telling him what the problem is? Because if I tell him what the problem is, he's not going to believe it. And he's going to be defensive, but once he realizes himself what the problem is, he goes like, oh shit. And then you just need to help him find a solution. So yeah, externals are often easier in that. But after half a year, you also get the problem that you're too much into the organization and you have to find another one. So coaches, good coaches have a like limited lifetime often in an organization. So. Okay. Couple of tools. This is where we could talk all evening, all night. So I'm just gonna quickly go through a couple of things that you might need here.
And by the way, the presentation will be later available on Webex.
The slides will be. I guess the video will also. There's not that much in my slides, so
yeah,
I don't know what much.
No, there will be links, so probably.
Yeah, but I will put it on SlideShare anyway, so no problem then. So, first one that I'm talking about, product vision. Have a good product vision. This is the big goal where your whole thing is going. If you don't have a clear product vision, you don't have a goal where to go. In the training, we even writing one. Have some examples. You know the Kennedy speech from "We are going to the moon" thing? You know, that's a product vision. It describes a desired end state where we want to go, and that motivates a lot of people. You know what you're going to do, the big thing. I have another example of the iPod vision. Apple had a nice concrete vision for creating an iPod. So write a vision for your project or product. Get the people to subscribe or share that vision so that everyone believes in that vision. It makes no sense if you have a vision that only the management believes in, but no one else. You need a vision that everyone is committed to and can believe in. This might mean you need to communicate quite a bit. You might have to involve a lot of people in the creation of the vision to get them to buy into it. But once you have one, you have a common direction for the organization. By the way, getting an organization to agree on one vision is actually bunch of directors, VPs, higher up people, and have them agree on one thing. One key benefit, for example, that we want to build in our product. That's a difficult discussion because there are so many different ideas that they have, so many things that everyone wants to get in there, that agreeing on one thing is really tricky. And often it makes sense to agree on, this is the most important thing of our product. Let's make that good. Too many products are like trying to service everyone between the sun and the moon. Anyone seen these kind of products that like do almost anything? These huge things, pull-ups. Compare that with a product that's really specific on a certain need and does it really well. Usually works much better. The other thing is, figure out what the requirements are. In this here, I mean with requirement, what is the customer or user need that you're trying to solve? I don't mean with requirement the system shall blah 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 blah. I mean, what is the need of a system? I'm sorry, not system, customer. What's the real need? Why would you buy this product? What is the problem you're trying to solve? Understand that. In many projects or products, this is totally skipped. They go directly to backlog, which is solution. Let's build a button that does this when I click it. Yeah, but why do I need the button? Another thing is, if you're in the customer-supplier relationship, your customer often comes to you saying, I want a bridge, build me one. In that case, you would have to ask him, so why do you want a bridge? What's the reason for one? You know, okay, you have the river here, but why do you want a bridge over that river? What are you trying to do? Is it that on the other side is your house, and on the other side, I don't know, there's your summer house or something, and you're going over like a couple of times a year? Do you really need a bridge 50 meters long? Maybe a rowing boat might be a better solution. Another example might be, okay, yeah, so you need 100,000 cars a day to go over there. And plus you want boats to go, big ships along the river, right? Maybe a tunnel might be better than a bridge. You know, building a high, or a 50-meter high boat, you know, the one that goes between Riga and Stockholm to go under the bridge. Kind of tricky. So let's build a tunnel. Often the customer thinks he wants something, a certain thing, and he just doesn't know what other options he has. Because who has the technical competence to build different things? The team, or the supplier. You're the building experts of bridges, or actually crossing river experts. In this case, if you're in your software context, then you're the experts in building whatever web services you're building, for example, for your customers. We've built 100 of them. You know, a lot of different ways you can build a web service. So we need to understand what is it actually that you need, what do your users need, so we can provide you with a solution tailored to that need. And that's going to fulfill your need much better than what you actually thought in the beginning, and it might be much cheaper. If you actually need, instead of a bridge, you need a rowing boat, the rowing boat is going to be a lot cheaper than the bridge. Does it make the customer more happy? Of course it does. He just saved a ton of money. If you built him the bridge, by the way, and then half a year later he found out that he should actually have boarded the boat and saved a ton of money, what is his reaction to the supplier?
But what is the reaction of company if you like cut the project, which would
bring a lot of money?
First of all, the customer would be more happy with your supplier if the supplier gave him the cheaper option. However, if he finds out that the supplier gave him the expensive option, when there actually was a cheaper option, and the supplier knew that there was a cheaper option, he's going to be pretty pissed with the supplier usually. What does it mean for our follow-up business?
They can pretend they didn't know that it's cheaper.
Then I would suspect that my supplier is incompetent because it's the same result, so I wouldn't buy from them again. You were saying something?
Yeah, I wanted to ask, does it happen often that they find out about this cheaper solution? Because it's also tricky to say if it would have really been a cheaper option and if it would fit.
It is tricky for them to find out, yeah. but they sometimes do find out. But it's tricky, because if you have a big system, it's really difficult to know, and no one really knows what they really needed in the end. So, however, if you get a couple of customers where you really help them out like that, what's your reputation going to be like with those customers? And customers talk. If you don't think customers don't talk to each other, they talk to each other. Go to any kind of trade show, you know, these kind of places where a lot of the business execs of those talk to each other in the sauna or something.
No, yeah, it's a long-term thinking. That's also a rare thing. Yeah.
But long-term thinking is really important.
Yeah, of course.
It's just different business styles. Yes. For long-time relationship and short-time cash.
Yeah. I know, and that's also a cultural thing in different countries. There are certain countries where the culture is always in the, or not always, but at the moment, at least in the short term. And there are countries where the business culture is a lot in the long term. Good example of really long term business cultures are Japan, for example. Japanese companies are known for thinking a lot in the long term and not really caring about the short term that much. They always plan long term. They don't mind if it's going to be the best thing in 10 years. So they have patience. And then there are countries where it's, I want money right now, I don't care what happens in half a year, because I'm going to be in a different company anyway, so I don't care what happens to this company. So that's the other extreme. I don't know where Latvia is, so I don't know the business here. I've heard from Estonians that Estonian companies are on the short term end of those things.
Not possible here, vice
versa. At least that's what Estonians told me when I talked to some Estonians. I don't know about Russians, but I would guess Russians are also quite on the short term. Chinese definitely are also on the short term. It's all about getting money right now and not really caring what happens in 10 years with the company reputation and these kind of things. So with Chinese, that's why they have problems with, like with the milk powder they had at one point that poisoned babies and stuff like that. On the long term thinking, that's like an insane thing to do, right? In the short term, they probably made nice money out of it. And they had a lot more things there. My girlfriend is Chinese, so I hear a lot of stories from her about things. Apparently, at the moment, this year they had something with yogurts, so no one in China wants to buy Chinese yogurts, they want foreign yogurts because the Chinese yogurts have some problems. They're making them extremely cheap and tasting really nice, but the healthiness of them is somehow poor. So be careful. Requirements. Figure out what the customer need is. So, this is something that I'm putting in here just to give you some kind of different concrete tool. How many know planning poker? Roughly half? Those who don't know, ask the ones that know. Relative business value estimation. This is a tool for if you have stakeholders who cannot agree on what is important in your valuable in your product. You know, you have a bunch of requirements or big user stores called epics. You have usually something big, don't try to do this with small ones. Is have them estimate value in relation to each other. You know, you have so let's say these are some user stories. Don't mind that they are cards. Big user stories. Which one is more valuable? This one and this one. From a business point of view, if you're the stakeholder, you know? You can ask them, this one is more valuable for you than this one. This is a lot easier to ask than how many euros is this, please? That's a very difficult question to answer. How many euros is this value to you? But it's easier to answer, this one is more valuable than this one. That's the difference between relative estimation. Now you can put numbers on this relation. You can say this value is 100, and this doesn't have any unit, it's completely unitless. It just says 100. This one is 300, which just means that this is 3 times more valuable than this one. Still doesn't mean any euros or anything, just a relation between each other. Okay? Now that's a question you can use with stakeholders. Now get a whole bunch of stakeholders in a room and have them do that at the same time, without them knowing what the other one is going to choose. You know? All of you have cards like this. input, just add a couple of zeros. Business people like big numbers. Otherwise you could use a 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, so, and so on. So we just make numbers, same card with just some slightly bigger numbers. And you do the same thing. So you have some kind of you're comparing to, and you ask them, so if this is 300, how valuable is this other story? Or epic, or feature, or requirement, or whatever. And have the guys pick whatever they think is the right answer from their perspective. They all show it at the same time, and you get huge differences. You know, one guy might say it's 100, the other one says 1,200, and so on. And then you can have meaningful discussions around this. Why is it 1,200 for you, while it is only 100 for you? Because in a lot of organizations, a product owner has a problem that he's sitting between different business people and different business stakeholders and these kind of things. We don't talk to each other that much. And they just come to him complaining that my thing is more important than anything else. Do my stuff, don't do theirs. And what you want to do is get them to agree on what is the most important thing for the company. So you need some kind of facilitation technique to get people to align and agree and talk to each other. And you can use techniques like this, like business value game, as a facilitation technique, get people to talk. And just agree on what is important for their company. If you want more detailed instructions, just Google for it on our website or something. We have a full page on with downloadable PDF and telling you exactly how to run it. And if you want cards, we have cards, but you can also just take any planning poker cards and just use them. I just think it's more nice to have bigger numbers in there. And it also makes the numbers a little different, so you don't accidentally think it's story points if they end up on some card or something, because it's a completely different number scheme. So that's like one thing you could try. So another thing that might be interesting is think about what is your minimum marketable product, or minimum viable product, or minimum marketable feature, or however you want to call it. So when you're building a backlog or release, what is the absolute minimum that you need to build for it to make any sense to someone? Let's say you're building a SaaS system. What is the minimum set of functionality you need so that you could, for example, do a closed internal alpha version in your company? You know? What is the minimum set? What is the minimum set of functionality you need to do, I don't know, a beta for a selected group of customers? This is where a lot of product owners have a lot of problems in actually making it the most small thing that they can think of. Let's say you have a SaaS system. One thing that they always want to have in there is a login. Why do you need a login in a system that you're testing? You know? You're doing a closed beta. There's no real data in your system. Why do you need a login system? Just put a page that has a link with the different user roles that you have, and you're done with it. You don't need a login system at that point yet. You need a login system when you sell it to the customer, but you don't need it there. But still, a lot of people start, when they think about a web service, they start with, we need a login. That's the first thing we built. Log out, and probably sign up, or something like that.
Forgot password.
Because I had this with a product when I'm building a product. They were building this kind of stuff before they were building anything else. And what they actually should be much more helpful than is build the actual functionality that they have in there. Test that, show it to users to make sure that the functionality makes any sense for the user, that the user actually wants to pay for it before they put any money into building a login or a forgot password functionality. They also had some other crazy things. They wanted to do a Facebook integration before the product did even anything. Because Facebook is cool, so the CTO wanted Facebook. We need to have Facebook in here. But we don't have any functionality. Yeah, but we need Facebook. They had these functions. It was so bad that actually the CTO got, let's not say his name, but it started, let's say, with an S. So we got some S surprises.
building an airplane, like a complex project, and everything seems to be shuttle. You're building, and, oh, we need this for safety, and we need this for that. And so.
Well, even in that case, first you build a carcass that's just flying.
So let's say you're building an airplane. Do you need to build a complete airplane in the first version?
You don't need seats, you don't need...
You don't need seats, you don't need any interior, definitely. You could cut that out, definitely.
And you don't build a kitchen in that.
But actually, the question is, where's your biggest risk in your airplane product? You know? Where's the big uncertainty in that? And what is the biggest thing you need to validate if you have a technological problem and you're uncertain about the engine technology, for example? You just build a damn engine. You know, put the engine on something and run the engine, see if it works. Without flying it, if that's the thing. If it's, I don't know, something else, like the aerodynamics, you could just build a small model with the aerodynamics without, you know, scale like this, put it in the wind tunnel and see if it works.
No, I think you're right, but the problem is that user wants the interior of the airplane, not the engine.
Yeah.
You are saying that the most hardest part is
it's
the engine.
Worse, the business wants the engine,
yeah,
not the engine.
You want to concentrate on the engine, yeah, because we want seats, they're describing how they want seats with
leather.
On
Facebook.
Yeah, on Facebook.
It's the same thing.
Yeah.
Let's just see the cool thing. They want the first class seats.
Yeah.
That's the most important thing for them in the airplane, but unfortunately that's not going to fly on its own.
Yeah.
So sometimes you get in this problem that even your business people or someone like wants something that doesn't make sense from the product perspective. And you need to explain to them that we have to test some other things there. But figure out and be truly honest with yourself, what is the absolute minimum you can get away with? And then cut it in half. Probably you can. That's by the way where an external sometimes helps, because we're not emotionally attached to the product. So we can be brutally ask questions there. Do you need that? I think you can cut that. And then the product owner goes like, yeah, you're right, let's cut it.
What does that do with the brakes?
Sure, if you're going to test it, then it takes off, you don't need brakes. Landing is not important. Well, you just put an autopilot in there and you crash the plane.
Yeah.
It took off, and then you crash it. Sure, that might be a viable thing to do.
About the product, like about patient, we as much as is needed to keep him alive.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, legs and hands will be off.
Mm-hmm.
It's the criteria. When the patient dies, it means it's got too much. We should keep it. But everything what is above should go.
Find out what the absolute minimum is.
Where?
And then cut another half out of it. Because most likely you're still wrong.
And certainly if you see it like a patient, then if you cut half, he's dead.
So I've also like have examples of you can if you just want knowledge about your product or what you're building, you don't necessarily need to even build a product to get that knowledge. You know, if you want to figure out if your product makes any business sense? You might do a prototype. You might do a complete paper prototype.
Mm-hmm.
That might be your first release kind of release. Do you have a complete paper prototype or just a discussion? And you show or talk to someone and find out something about the thing you're doing. One example I've used is the Dropbox, for example. Anyone use Dropbox? The first kind of release of Dropbox was what? Anyone know that? The beta sign up for Dropbox was the first kind of release that they did. So, release in. Because there was absolutely no software at that point. All the release was a video of demonstrating how Dropbox would benefit you. And then basically on YouTube or something, and having a sign up page. Here you can put in your email address and you can sign up for the beta. What was the first version?
And probably some comments. What did
you could write some comments and stuff like that.
Yeah.
No software at all.
Yeah.
And they got people to sign up. That was the first place where they got feedback from people and understand that our product makes actually sense because people are wanting to sign up for it. They're interested, they're excited, that they want to get it.
That's marketing.
but it's also product development. Because at the same time you're validating. Because they made a video of how you would use your product, and they were asking people, is this what you want? And people were saying, this is what I want. So they were in the right, going in the right direction of something that happened. So they had a good idea.
But it's not just marketing. I disagree. You have to put some technical persons to validate these ideas. They're not selling the...
They were asking the users, basically,
yeah,
by showing them the video.
But yeah, but also validate that it's technically possible. Like sometimes...
Yeah, marketing is feasible to build.
Yeah.
Of course, that's also something you need to do.
You're finding the requirements, actually.
Yeah. Of course, if you figure out that it's completely unfeasible to implement, you need to choose another thing to build. It sometimes happens in software development.
Marketing sells such things that when developers see it,
yeah. It takes us 10 years to build this thing. Yeah, of course. So you need both in there. Again, a good argument for having cross-functional teams, by the way. Put a marketing guy and a development guy in the same team to figure out what the product would be. Because on their own, the marketing guy would come up with a crazy idea that isn't buildable. And also, if you put the technical guy in there, he builds a nice technical framework or something that no one's going to buy ever, because it's just like not interesting to anyone except the technical guy. So you end up with these kind of things. So these were kind of like examples of different things that you can think of. Plus, of course, there are plenty of other tools out there that you can use. Just Google for them, go to a training, read a book, think about them. You can invent them yourself. But these were a couple of ones that I've go through when I work with product owners. In my opinion, at least, the product owner should have and understand definitely the vision, the requirements, and the minimal product. Those three he has to have. Otherwise, it's usually a bit going in the wrong direction. So, thank you for your time. This was actually much longer than what I did in Vilnius, because there I had only 45 minutes, so here we spent like over an hour already. Which was great, so I could talk a little bit more. Also, we had more interaction because less people. It's difficult when you have like 100 people or 50 people in the room. It's pretty difficult to see. So, do you have any other questions? I guess we still have until 8, right? Then the hotel is going to kick us out.
Well, not really in that kind of action. But something like that.
Sure.
Regarding the project manager, how that relates to Scrum Master? Yeah, that's a usual question, you know?
Yeah, I know.
Because you have this background, the legacy.
Yeah. So,
what do we do with this project manager?
The cool answer? Remove the role, but not the person. So if you think about it, what does a project manager do? Well, I'm simplifying a lot here now, but project manager does what kind of things?
Managing the team,
decisions.
Decisions, what kind of decisions? Let's go.
About the product.
Scope, priority, this kind of things. That sounds like a product owner, right?
Yeah.
You know, if you were a project manager and you did a gun chart, basically by drawing a gun chart and putting the stuff in there, you're creating an order of things that you're going to build. Goes in the same direction as a product backlog. It's not a product backlog, but it goes in the same direction. The product owner does these kind of things. Let's go into, as you said, mentioned the working with the team. You know? He works with the team, supports the team, and this kind of thing. Sounds like Scrum Master, right?
Scrum Master.
Yeah. In some companies, product managers might be responsible for, let's say, product quality, these kind of things. That's going all to the team, actually. So you can actually take the project manager role, and a lot of the responsibility he has gets split between the three Scrum roles. Maybe not more responsibilities. There might be responsibilities that are not existing in the Scrum roles at all. So for those responsibilities, you have to think about what you want to do in that organization. Do you keep those with whatever you want to call it, the project manager, or something else? You want to put those responsibilities somewhere else? Do you need those responsibilities? You might also have responsibilities that you don't need anymore at all. An example might be certain reporting responsibilities. Because if you create a transparent way of working with dashboard or task boards and these kind of things on the wall, Do you need to create a weekly slide set report? Perhaps not. So you would lose certain responsibilities completely. But you need to figure out what you're going to do. And don't choose the first thing, you fire them all. That's probably not a good thing. In general, most project managers actually make quite good product owners. Much better product owners than Scrum Masters. Most of them. Depends on the individual a lot.
And that's probably the search for a Scrum Master in classical or
testers.
Well, usually there's also a team lead person that doesn't do too much business.
Team leads are a bit sketchy often. Female tester. Women make usually much better Scrum Masters than men.
Okay.
And testers are used to talking to a lot of people about problems and stuff like that. But that's again just a generalization.
Yeah.
And it depends on the individual, which you can find anywhere. Just find the right person. Don't make someone a Scrum Master just because we have to find someone. You know, it's kind of like the game where you have five chairs and you have six people. The last one standing is the one who gets the Scrum Master role. Don't do that. I've seen that also in organizations. Not a good idea usually. That guy just wants to get rid of that role as quickly as possible and give that to someone else. And that means that you don't actually have anyone doing that role at all. They just get rid of it. Any other question?
In the case of a project owner thinking that he's the greatest product owner in the world,
mm-hmm.
and as a coach you're trying to show him, for example, that he thinks he's doing everything correctly but he has to improve certain areas,
mm-hmm.
how do you communicate that thought?
Well, that depends on what the problem there is. I can't give you an answer there. Generally, the thing is you ask questions. You don't tell him that you're bad, and you're doing it wrong there. Try to ask open-ended questions, multiple powerful questions, open-ended questions, that make him think and challenge his own assumptions. But more than that, I can't say without having the actual product in front of me and saying what his thing is. But that's the general idea of it.
You described that a certain company, you asked people to choose their roles.
Mm-hmm.
How did it go? Was it successful and were the choices pretty expected? Or?
Yeah, pretty much. Because people have the option of taking what they wanted. So they take what they feel comfortable with and what they feel there. And you had enough of them, so you didn't have like people left over. You know, that's also one thing you want to kind of look after, that it's not becomes a thing that once people are left over get fired or something. That's not a good thing to go. It's definitely better to let them choose what they want than assign them to someone, because you will make a lot of mistakes when you assign roles to people. And of course it's more tricky and it's more difficult to get the high management to accept it, because you're kind of letting the organization self-organize. You give them, here are the constraints. We have to fill all these spots basically. But you guys figure out who goes where, so you guys figure it out. And they need to talk to each other, and of course if two people want the same kind of role and there's only one spot for that role, they need to negotiate with each other, so who gets it? And they need to figure out between each other. I've also had, not myself, but a friend of mine had an organization, they did that with teams. So they put up all the projects and products they had. And they had the constraints, so we have to staff every single project we have. It needs to have a certain size of team. It needs to have all the skills required for that project. And they roughly listed what kind of stuff it needs. And then they put everyone in the company in a huge room. So they rented a big hall, much bigger than this. I think like 100 people or something like that. And told them, you figure out where you want to work, in what project. Go and do it.
But what do you do with popular projects where usually,
there's a maximum size of people that can work on that.
Who gets
the people
the strongest one?
They need to discuss that among each other. Negotiate with each other who gets to go there. Also, you can't just have all the most brilliant guys in one project and all the new guys who just joined last week in the other project doesn't also work. You can set that constraint that if you have like the senior and the junior guys, you cannot have more than, let's say, two senior guys in a project. And you cannot have more than four junior guys in a project. You can set these kind of rules, but within those rules, the people can choose. Again, this is a very scary thing for a lot of managers to do in their companies, because no one is deciding who goes where. The benefit is you end up with teams that are often quite good, because people who don't like each other don't end up in the same team. So the team dynamics are much different. So you end up with people who like to work together, which adds that they will be much more productive because they work together nicely. And you don't get this kind of, I hate you, I don't want to work with you, so that creates a lot of turbulence and problems in a team. And that can make a significant difference in performance. Huge in software. You know this, that there's a huge difference in performance in software development. The most brilliant developer and the most crappy developer, the difference between is like insanely big. And even if you have a brilliant guy, if you put him in the wrong team, he might be like really crap in that team. You might even have teams where someone seems to not be doing anything, but he's the most important guy in the team. Anyone ever had that? You know, he doesn't code, he doesn't seem to be doing anything. The moment he's away, the whole team collapses. He was just the guy who kept everyone else working. You know, and kept them in the right direction. Kind of like a mother figure, you know? Giving them, this is what we're doing, and this, and you take him out.
It's the Scrum Master.
Yeah. Might be a Scrum Master, might be someone else. Might also just be a developer that keeps everyone else going in the right direction and help them out. Once talked to someone from the US who had a person like that in the team. Actually, they said that that person, no, it was actually repair programming. The best pair they had was the pair where the other guy had what syndrome he had. He had some problem, a genetic problem. His IQ was something like 70, but he was actually a great guy to pair with because he had to explain everything in really simple terms for him to understand, which made the brilliant guys think much more easily. So when they paired with him, they actually produced better software than when they paired with each other. You put two brilliant guys together, they were worse than the brilliant guy with a not so brilliant guy.
That actually kind of makes sense if you have two brilliant guys working together. They're both thinking that they're better than the other group.
Yeah. So you get this kind of weird things happening. Cool. What else?
Yeah. Well, personal life, where can you apply these principles from? Have you thought about, like, oh, I can take this from my professional life and apply some of these principles to managing my personal life? It's just similar, like, I asked whether you can apply Kanban in your... Yeah, we had a topic, whether you can apply Kanban in personal life.
So I haven't done it.
Yeah.
However, I know of a family where the family is running the Scrum. and we're talking about the children here. In that family, the children are homeschooled. So the mother homeschools the children, for example. And the mother is the product owner, providing the backlog, which might be like topics that the children have to cover. They're prioritized. However, the children need to choose as much as they can do in 1 week, how many topics they can cover and this kind of stuff. So they're running it like that.
Yeah.
They have a great talk, by the way, at the conference, if they ever wanted to talk about it.